How many coming? Good afternoon, Arushi.
Good afternoon.
Take your seat. Are you doing a master's in political science as of now?
Yes, sir. I am in the middle of my master's with political science from Indira Gandhi National Open University, sir. I've completed 1 year, but the next year is still
pending. It's going on.
Right, sir.
Okay. And you've never appeared for NET exam?
Sir,
NET
GRF? I think, sir, you have to have your
MA. You have to complete your master's.
Right, sir, as a criteria.
Okay. So until and unless your master's isn't complete, you don't become eligible for the same.
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What was the last debate you were a part of?
Sir, it has been quite a while professionally that I have been a part of debate. So this was in college, final year, sir, 2014.
What was the issue around which you debated?
Sir, I think it was, does India need a uniform civil code?
And you were a votary for yes, it does need a civil code.
Sir, I was a votary for no.
You were a votary for no?
Right.
Why?
Sir, because
do you stand by that opinion even now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and how would you justify it?
Sir, in my opinion, the idea of uniform civil code has been slightly borrowed from the Western conception of secularism. I understand that uniform, the major argument given in favor of a uniform civil code is that it will help promote gender justice. But in my opinion, that idol can be secured even without pushing a uniform civil code. And by preserving the Indian idea of secularism, which you, as you may already know, sir, is based on positive secularism and based on preserving the multicultural fabric of our society. And also, sir, a big part of the debate arises because no one actually has an idea on what an Indian form of uniform civil code will look like. So until and unless we have some deliberation and a broad framework exists, sir, I'm afraid I cannot give a very firm opinion whether uniform civil code is needed or not.
We'll come to this. We'll definitely come to it after some time. And what is the last piece of fiction which you have read?
Sir, I think day before yesterday, I finished A Fine Balance by Rohinder Mistry, sir.
That's easier to book.
Right, sir. Sir, a friend recommended
so
that book.
You were so late in reading it.
Sir, in my choices, I rely on what friends have recommended me, and my friend was like, you know, this is one author, and I'm sir, I was not exposed to mystery before this. So he said, you must start from this book. So I said, all right.
So it's Indian English fiction that you normally go through.
Right, sir. Not just English, sir. Not, I wouldn't say just Indian origin authors fiction. I have read, Sir Jane Eyre and Sir Emma by Jane Austen and Sir Charlotte Bronte, Wuthering Heights, all these. Sir, crudely we can say that Victorian era English fiction is something I have read.
You have read?
Right.
You're interested in?
Right, sir.
And nothing as far as the recents are concerned?
Any 2018 releases, I'm afraid I haven't had the time to read, sir.
2017, 2016. When you were in college?
Sir, I'll have to recollect. I've read The Lowlands by Jhumpa Lahiri. That's a relatively recent release.
Okay. Why do we have this problem in India when it comes to fictional writing? You have heard about this controversy related to this Tamil novelist called as Perumal Murugan?
Yes, I've read the book as well. One part only.
Okay, so why are Indians not able to get a hold over this whole thing that at the end of the day it's only fiction? So why do we get so worked up with it?
Sir, I would say that as a phenomena, this issue is not you would observe in the entire society. Yes, some sections would
entire society, the man had to be located in a different place altogether.
It
was in imminent danger. He had stopped writing for a whole year. Now, what more do you want in terms of entire society?
So I would still like to believe that we are a relatively tolerant, open-minded society, and I would like to look at it as an exception. But definitely, there is no way we can defend what Peribal Murugan had to go through.
No, but why does it happen in the first place? Why has it happened?
So I think people are very sensitive about their identity, and they are also concerned that their community should be projected only in a certain way. And for example, sir, in the case of Peribal Murugan, issues related to the honor of a woman and how a woman is portrayed, etc., related to the particular community.
I don't understand all of that, but the whole point is it's just fiction at the end of the day.
No, sir.
What is it about fiction that so agitates people's minds? I can keep on multiplying examples, starting off from that very first grand one which happened in the 1980s when the government of India banned a novel.
The Satanic Verses.
Mm-hmm. Which wasn't even available for publication in India, or wasn't even been distributed in India. Satanic Verses had been released in Britain,
yeah.
And the government of India almost preempted something by saying that okay, it's the Penguin didn't even possibly have a policy of distributing it in India.
Yes, sir.
Starting from all the way from there, why is fiction something that so agitates the minds of certain people? Is there something about fiction?
Sir, perhaps issue would be that people are concerned that fiction at the end of the day has some inspiration from reality, and people are concerned that the wider reading world may actually confuse that as the actual phenomena which happens in the community. I mean, not everyone would apply their mind and think, okay, this is only fiction and this is not reality, and they are concerned that the name of their community might go down. So yes, sir, perhaps they think that not everyone.
What is the mechanism of doing this in India? Are you aware of what sections of the penal code are normally applied when it comes to getting works of fiction banned?
Sir, as far as I remember, in that case, section 295A. Sir, it's called the Indian version of blasphemy law, attempt to outrage religious feelings of a certain section. That was
there anything else?
Yes, sir, just give me a moment to recollect. So the defamation law, I think, sir, section 499 and 500 of the IPC.
Okay. And as someone who loves to read fiction, you think this is the right thing to do? You think this is the wrong thing to do?
Sir, I'd say it would depend on the context. Definitely, if you in the usual course of things in a democracy, people should be entitled to exercise their freedom of expression, which includes the freedom to write as they please. It's been called the creative freedom. But sir, if in some cases there is imminent danger to law and order, so in some cases, sir, it would be advisable that things are managed in a way that the law and order aspect as well as the freedom of religion, freedom of expression aspect can be balanced.
But just going back to a certain point that you made a couple of minutes ago, blasphemy is a Western concept. Blasphemy was imported into Indian law by the Indian Penal Code. We never had the idea of blasphemy being legislated upon or being punished by law prior to the coming of the Penal Code.
I would say, sir, that Article 25, freedom of religion, an essential part of it is that you feel respected as an individual as well as a community. So I think that section is necessary in a multicultural society like ours, just that every group, irrespective of their religious identity, feels that they are respected enough.
You are aware of what's going on in this place called as Kerala, with the Chief Minister having had decided to behave in the what I would term the outrageous way in which he is behaving. I feel that the Kerala Chief Minister is mad, to put it mildly, to uphold a judgment of the Supreme Court of India by alienating such a massive public opinion in his state, by almost provoking people to embark on those acts of violence that they have embarked on, just to provide cover for a couple of women who want to go and pray at a certain shrine. Don't you think it's madness?
Sir, if we talk in terms legally, sir, that perfectly right decision which has been they are, sir, only upholding the judgment of the Supreme Court.
But in the face of that massive thing.
Right, sir. Sir, a better, in my opinion, the most critical thing is to win the trust and the consensus of the temple board. So, in my opinion, once their opposition drops and they are mentally, because sir, as you know, the purification ritual was also performed as soon as the women entered. So, in their minds, the judgment has not been accepted yet. So perhaps a better way forward would have to be, win the consensus and the support of the temple board, and that way a more
immediate. If you were appointed as a civil servant, an administrative officer, in charge of this district wherein this temple is located, you have any idea where is it located? In what district of Kerala?
So I can hazard a guess, but I'm not sure. Sir, is it Idukki? I'm not sure, sir.
Okay, whatever be the district. So, if you were posted as an administrator, as the district's top administrative officer, and you were charged by the Kerala Chief Minister to initiate a process of bringing the temple board on board to abide by the judgment of the Supreme Court of India, how would you go about doing the same?
Sir, all the major stakeholders, so there's a women group, the temple board, as well as the law.
No, forget everybody else. You are supposed to strike a dialogue. You are supposed to get along with the temple board.
Yes.
To bring them on board with this idea that they are supposed to abide by the Supreme Court's judgment. So how would you do that?
Sir, as you said, dialogue is the way forward. I would speak to them, and sir, my goal would be to let them feel that they are not defeated by this decision. Allow them to feel that they still have a legitimate stake and legitimate voice in the issue. So I would say them that, look, this is something we need to do together, and probably I would allow them some time to make the arrangements, as well as to mentally accept the fact that women will be entering the temple, and I would request them to offer their cooperation in public as well about the matter, so that the protest could.
Are you aware of when did this matter go to the courts for the first time?
I think, sir, way back in when a Kerala High Court judgment actually upheld the ban.
So when was that?
Sir, I would not be sure of the year.
I'll tell you. This started in 1991. So it was in 1991 that the temple board approaches the Kerala High Court. The High Court upholds the ban of whatever the thing is, and the case goes to the Supreme Court in 2004. And it has been lying around with the Supreme Court till the court doesn't come up with this judgment in 2018. So if you look at the legal process, this has been in the offing for almost the last two decades. Almost. Okay. So, one part of your job, Ayushi, in terms of making them feel that they're stakeholders in all of this, I don't know how much of it works, for a very simple reason. Because they are aware of a legal challenge to what they have been doing for the last two decades.
Mm-hmm.
So this is not something that has, this is not a bolt out of the blue that has struck them one fine morning. They have been aware of this fact that the sort of privileges which they enjoy as far as the shrine is concerned have been under a legal challenge for the last two decades. And for the last two decades, if someone is aware of the fact that my privileges have been challenged, you're not doing something new by informing them that, well, after all of this, you can be a part of the entire thing. So how does one approach that?
Sir, my opinion, because as you mentioned, the judgment was still sub judice, they had that little glimmer of hope perhaps, and especially because the ban had been actually upheld by the Kerala High Court, so I think they were perhaps expecting that the ban will again be upheld. And sir, right now also I would say the opposition persists because they have that little glimmer of hope, and the judgment, a review petition is actually waiting. So once it is done, full and final, I think they will be more open to persuasion. So a similar case happened with the Haji Ali Darga in Mumbai, where the ban was eventually accepted by the Darga authorities. So I would like to hope, sir, that a similar process will be underway at the Shabrimala temple once the final decision is done and the state government has already displayed its intent to enforce the judgment.
Shabrimala and Haji Ali is one and the same?
No, sir, it is not one and the same, but sir, broadly I would say the issue.
One and the same?
Yes, sir.
Huh?
No, sir, not one and the same, but sir, broadly the conflict between tradition and women equality and women's right to practice their religion is same.
At Haji Ali, the argument was about the devotees getting diverted during their prayers by the presence of women in the sanctum. At Shabrimala, the point is about the deity not wanting women in the sanctum.
Yes, sir, that is
the question. I hope. Your father is an additional special Uttar Pradesh SP, that's superintendent of police. That's the most dangerous thing to do in Uttar Pradesh these days.
But for my father also the most rewarding, I would say.
Most rewarding?
Right, sir.
Why are police officers in Uttar Pradesh being lynched?
Sir, that has, we cannot cite one factor for that, sir. But definitely, one is the issue of, sir, impunity. Sir, the people, sir, mob actually also brings along an element of anonymity. And then people feel that, like I said, sir, impunity. You can feel that, you feel that you can do anything and get away with it. And, sir, the criminal justice system, there is declining trust in the criminal justice system. So people somewhere also feel the need for immediate and at the moment justice. And apart from that, sir, the social fabric also is kind of changing for the worse. In multiple ways, sir, there is some sort of polarization underway. So, sir, all these factors have come together to...
Very interesting. Very, very interesting.
Sir, I would say not interesting, but...
No. Are you sure that these are the only factors because of which this is happening? So, there's something called as mobs. There's something called as a criminal justice system, which is failing people. There is something called as a social fabric, which is changing. So, as someone, that's very interesting. That's the reason why I said. As someone who is the immediate kin of someone who is serving in the Uttar Pradesh police, to say that everybody but the police is responsible for the state of affairs. That is what I said is very interesting.
Sir, when I mentioned criminal justice system, I implied that, sir, the entire machinery, including police and the courts.
How are the police responsible for this situation?
Sir, the police are the primary authorities who are supposed to enforce the law of the land. So, sir, if there is any failure in punishing similar incidents which have happened in the past, for example, sir, the Dadri lynching case had happened, and justice is not still done. So, sir, that is what encourages the mentality of...
How does one explain the phenomena of senior police officials joining electoral politics and becoming, for that matter of fact, partisan? A couple of months before you are offered a ticket by a political party to go and contest elections, you were an officer in uniform. And a couple of days after that, with nothing called as a cooling period in between,
yes,
join partisan politics. So isn't that a sign of a complete failure as far as the police are concerned?
Right, sir. So, definitely, sir, this is problematic because political neutrality is one of the key attributes which is expected from police personnel. And sir, perhaps there is need to ensure some sort of cooling period and law mandate rules like that. But sir, I would also say that in a democracy, the final judge are the people. So it is also incumbent upon the people to notice the trends and kind of not reward this kind of political behavior. Because sir, you cannot go on making laws and regulating everything. Something has to lie at the...
But on the flip side of this is the sort of incidences which are happening which involve the police.
Right, sir.
The problem is very simple. Whether the people reward it or don't reward it, whether we have laws or we don't have laws, if the police as an institution fail to understand and to come to terms, have a grip over the situation in terms of what does policing exactly entail. Okay, now one can understand this at the level of a beat officer. I can understand this at the level of a beat policeman. At the level of senior police officials playing partisan games, playing caste games, playing communal games, that at the end of the day is going to inevitably lead to this sort of a situation. When in the pursuit of your duties, you finally end up losing your lives. Tragic, but you have possibly brought this on yourself.
Sir, I am not really aware of many examples of this kind. Sir, I have grown up seeing sir, my father as well as sir, Shiv Prakash Singh, you know, sir, the famous, he had been the DGP of UP, sir, who had actually pushed the PIL in Supreme Court for police reforms. So the case for police reform is undeniable, sir. But I would also say that, in my opinion, not everyone has that kind of mentality. Definitely, there is some issue of institutional bias, and that needs to be addressed at the level of training. But again, like I said, sir, I've grown up seeing people like that. And also, sir, the working conditions and other related reforms in police system, those need to be looked at. It cannot be just at the
seen
level
of... Solution. I do understand that. I do understand. That's extremely important. But that's exactly what is not happening. Your politicians leave the police in that sort of a situation, completely dependent on them and their largesse for practically everything. It's like a vicious circle in which we find ourselves now at the end of the day. Is it time that we detach police and policing functions from the state list and possibly push it into the concurrent list, or maybe push it further into the union list itself? Would that, in your opinion, remedy the situation?
Sir, in my opinion, that may be helpful if we have, if that becomes a tool to push police reforms. But again, sir, it will have its issues, because the police is something which needs decentralized sort of functioning. And to imagine that, you know, the diverse problems of policing to be handled at a central level, it makes it hard to, difficult to, it will be definitely a task managing it, sir. And again, sir, it will be a step back from our trend of federalism, progressive power to the state that we have been witnessing since the 1990s. So, sir, I think a better prospect would be that, again, sir, policing reforms at the level of the state is pushed, sir. Centralization would not be the best remedy, in my opinion.
Ayushin, at a global level, there is a certain apprehension as well as a ferocious debate around this whole idea of the rise of populism in politics. Are you aware of this?
Right, sir, it has been.
In your opinion, as a student of political science, constitutes populism in politics?
Sir, basically, it's an ideological viewpoint which subscribes to the right-wing perception. So, sir, it may involve xenophobia, so that, you know, you don't want to accept migrants or people from different communities other than yours. It is also involving economic protectionism in its recent upturn.
So, in your view, populists are essentially right-wing politicians?
No, sir. I think that would be a simplification. But, sir, in most of the cases, I subscribe to that kind of idea, that my nation for my own people who are perhaps born here only. So, that way. And, sir, like I said, economic protectionism and nationalism, and also, sir, phobia towards certain communities.
Why has this state of affairs come about?
Sir, in my opinion, 2008 was the year when this actually process got underway, and through, we are seeing it not peaking, but yeah, the most important manifestation through Brexit. And sir, it has been, sir, I would say economic issues, economic inequality per se, and concentration of wealth is one of the factors which is driving it. And also, sir, that thanks to globalization, there has been lot of immigration, but the mentality at the level of society in these nations has not really evolved in tune with the migration and the...
In these nations, so you mean to imply that we are not seeing any manifestation of this in the Indian context?
I would like to think a little about that, sir.
I'll just hint at certain things, I'll just give you a clue. You had elections in Madhya Pradesh, you had a new government coming into power, and one of the first things that the Chief Minister does in the first 72 hours is to declare that, well, he is going to go about promoting the cause of his people when it comes to employment within the state. You have at the opposite end a state like Karnataka, which is economically more prosperous as compared to Madhya Pradesh, but which nevertheless extremely, what I would term shamelessly, goes on promoting the interest of its of people domiciled in the state at the level of every argument of efficiency and economy by providing massive tax cuts and subsidies to firms which employ more people from Karnataka. So it's happening in the poorer states of India, it's happening in the richer states of India. You have strange type of people in cases like Maharashtra, who don't even manage to win elections but manage to have a lot of space as far as the national media is concerned, who make all these arguments about how we want to keep people who don't speak Marathi away from the state. So what sort of a world are we living in as far as India is concerned? Why talk about the West? It's happening right here in front of us.
Definitely, sir. Now that you've pointed out, I would agree that the trend is visible in India as well. But still, I would say that it is not aggravated as in the other countries. For example, if I were to compare it with USA, so the whole basis, their worldview, which had been signifying US to us so far, is seemingly being abandoned. So, for example, free trade and nation of immigrants and all those ideas. At least I would say that the basic ideas which have defined the Indian nation are not being sacrificed in this wave of populism. But yes, sir, it is certainly visible at the at the state level in some ways. And sir, part of again the agrarian distress and the lack of job creation is the major factor in these issues. So it is as much an
what is the jobs issue in India all about? Is there a jobs problem?
Definitely, sir.
And what is it all about? Because you have an equally impressive number of economists on the opposite side who insist on this, that these numbers are highly inflated. Possibly we don't need all these number of jobs that people are talking about. So there's an argument that on one hand which says that we need possibly 12 million jobs a year.
Yes.
Whereas there are equally impressive statistics on the opposite side to prove that we possibly don't even need more than 5 million jobs. Why is it that we are harping on 12 million? So there, as far as the economist community is concerned, there is a lot of divergence in terms of opinion as to how many number of jobs are required, how many people are exactly unemployed in India, how many people are in employment. So why do you think is there a sort of dissonance and a massive sort of disagreement at that level?
Sir, one, that is certainly an issue that the credibility of the economic data has come under the scanner recently. One of the reasons is that we have a huge informal economy and people are in and out of jobs and seasonal employment and all those things happen. So it is kind of difficult to put an exact estimate about what are the people who are, number of people who are employed. And as you said also, the estimate of numbers required, fresh job creation which is required. And sir, like I said, definitely there is a need to create jobs, because it's not just a question that you need to provide employment to people who are graduating and, you know, with better economic profile. It's also important that people who are currently stuck in the agriculture sector get fresh opportunities. And sir, in my opinion, more than a jobs problem, we have a problem of creating quality jobs with secure working conditions and with some sort of social security net. So that is the issue, sir. People do find employment, for example, sir, but in the construction sector. But we know the working conditions. So more than the jobs issue, we have a issue of quality jobs and jobs aligned to the aspirations of an average Indian. That is also.
Those are types of jobs which are not forthcoming.
Right, sir.
Okay. April 2019 was supposed to be the month in which the Afghan government was supposed to hold presidential elections.
Mm.
But now they have postponed them.
Right.
Have you heard of it?
Yes, sir.
So when are they now scheduled for?
I'm not sure.
And why have they postponed it?
Sir, I think the situation in the country because of destabilization and Taliban attacks.
But there is hardly any Taliban. The Americans are so sure about the fact that all of this has been defeated to a level that President Trump has declared that American troops would be withdrawn from Afghanistan. How do you look at this phenomenon of Trump dissociating himself from these extremely important battlegrounds, one in Afghanistan and two in Syria? So on one hand, it's a snub to the sort of foreign policies which were conducted by the Obama government. On the other hand, the jury is out on why exactly is this being done. Expert security opinion doesn't agree with what the president has done. The defense secretary has resigned. So how do you, as a student of international relations and international politics, look at this entire phenomenon? Why are the Americans doing it?
Sir, in my opinion, the narrative that the Taliban has been defeated, that suits the domestic agenda of US President Donald Trump. On the ground, the reality is that at least one third of the territory is directly controlled by the Taliban. So definitely, so the Taliban has not been defeated. And I think there are two issues which we can identify underlying this. One is that, as we had been talking about, US is taking an isolationist turn and it is no longer interested in retaining its role as a global policeman. And second is that Mr. Trump is interested that this electoral promise that he had made, that he'd get the troops back, that he's interested in fulfilling that promise. And sir, it's not just that he's contradicting the policy of former President Obama, he's contradicting his own policy as well, sir. The new US South Asia policy which had been declared in 2017, there also they had expressed that the intent is to defeat Taliban, but definitely now it seems that they are eager for a withdrawal at whatever terms that may come.
Okay. Okay. Going back to the Uniform Civil Code, you said that there's a Western idea of secularism and there's an Indian idea of secularism, and a Uniform Civil Code essentially stems from a very Western notion of things, which is untenable as far as we in India are concerned. And it does have an aspect of gender justice, as you rightly pointed out. So there is no other way by which gender justice can be achieved.
Right. So I was trying to say the same thing, that we can have gender justice without having a uniform
civil code. But how would that happen?
So like, this triple talaq law, which has been in the past, and previous to that, the judgment which has come from the Supreme Court. So, sir, that is one of the ways which actually we've seen a long pending reform come. Definitely, it's not very desirable that the reform has come from the level. It's a top-down reform in some ways, that it's come from the Supreme Court and the Parliament. But so going forward, definitely these individual codes of religions which exist, those can be reformed. And so currently, the Law Commission report is also studying the issue. And as far as I remember, sir, the.
But tell me one thing, Ayushi. What happens to citizenship? Because citizenship, for that matter of fact, as we have it in India, as we have been practicing it for almost the last 7 decades, is also a distinctly Western concept. In the pre-European situation, the pre-colonial situation in which we are in India, we had an idea of subjecthood. We never had an idea of citizenship. So citizenship is an equally Western import. And the more you delay or deny a Uniform Civil Code, the more you are hindering the process or the formation of a meaningful citizenship.
Sir, as far as I understand, the UCC is supposed to impose uniformity in terms of the rights and privileges one may enjoy thanks to their religion. But I think, sir, for a diverse country like India, uniformity is not a suitable way forward. And uniformity, in fact, may drive alienation in certain sections. And we have already witnessed that phenomena underway somewhat in European nations. So, sir, equality can be had in ways other than imposing uniformity. And sir, equality will only be there when everyone has equal freedom to enjoy their religious rights and equal freedom to practice their faith. But sir, equal does not imply uniform, in my opinion.
Okay, Ayushi, how do you look at gender as a factor in Indian politics?
Sir, as a factor in Indian politics, I would say that we have had some biases start from the modern times. Even if we go back to the time of Ramayana or Mahabharata.
No. Just focus on the contemporary politics.
Okay, sir. So we have had, sir, some big female politicians, but alongside that, it is also a reality that most of them have come from dynasties. So in terms of, and even despite their privileged background, they may face issues like, I mean, issues specific to female politicians like character assassination. And despite that, sir, like I mentioned, we have had some big names. And only now, sir, thanks to the night.
Now leadership is just one element of that.
Right, sir.
You want to go beyond that.
And gender is not only about women at the end of the day.
True, sir. In terms of their voting behavior, I don't have a very informed opinion, sir, but I would like to say that from what I have observed, women do exercise their independent judgment and do not necessarily vote along the pattern of the males in their family. But again, I would say, sir, that the stereotype regarding women, that they are disinterested in politics or unable to participate in politics, kind of still prevails. And thanks to the 92nd Constitutional Amendment Act, that has been broken somewhat, but we still need to go far. And that is why the Constitution Amendment Bill to push for women's reservation again has been brought back into debate.
So do you see any positive impact of globalization on Indian democracy?
Yes, sir. I think there is increased awareness of among citizens of basic concepts like human rights and of economic inequality, and we have had huge people-led movement. For example, sir, the India Against Corruption movement. That is a unique new social movement, and we have to look at it against the context of globalization and this awareness among citizens that government.
Are you sure it's a huge social movement? it began with an absolutely important concern and an extremely well-defined objective of appointing a Lokpal. There is no Lokpal. The movement started in 2011. We are almost at the end of the decade after its inception. There is yet no Lokpal. So that grand a failure, you see it as a success?
No, sir. So I think so. I was saying it is a new social movement, sir. That not a social movement along the lines of economic issues, but a more diverse issue which unites different sections of the society.
Even we witness, what to say, an agitation focusing on the issue of corruption long back.
Sir, I'm not sure what you're talking about.
The JP's movement.
Oh, right, sir, yes. That also, sir, I mean, there were
corruption was one of the important component of that, yes.
That also, then, sir, the leadership issue kind of comes in. There also, sir, the parties took advantage from the movement, but thereon it declined, and same, sir, in the India Against Corruption movement.
Do you see anything else as far as the impact of globalization on democracy is concerned, Indian democracy?
Sir, so I would like to think on it. Sir, the political mobilization trends have changed a little. I would say that factors like development maybe have become a little more important. And
but you are not sure. Maybe.
Because sir, I think we cannot make a statement for India as a whole. We are so diverse. And as you know, sir, the political dynamics is different at each state level. So,
do we have anything to offer to something called as parliamentary system and federal system of government? Our experiment, let us say, Indian experiment.
Right, so sir, one is again that, you know, how the representation has, the composition of parliament has changed, and how new social groups have been included. And also, sir, committee system is something which is functioning very well. I'm not saying it's an originally Indian idea, but definitely the way it functions in India is something other developing countries can benefit from.
And what about federalism?
Yes, sir. So federalism, how federalism interacts with the parliamentary democracy. That is also a uniquely Indian experience.
Thank you, Aishu. Thank you. Just give us 2 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update from the Unique Academy. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to our channel. Stay tuned.